path, I think, I'm not sure why. I actually started as a chemist, and I studied chemistry at university. When I was at university, I really never had a concept of scientists as communicators at all. I don't remember learning any communication skills, or if I did, I certainly didn't appreciate them or notice them or care about them at the time. And it wasn't until much later, when I became interested in interdisciplinary research, that I realized how important communication was. And I became really fascinated by how two totally different people, choosing a picture for you, could come together from totally different backgrounds, different skill sets, different knowledge bases, and solve a problem that separately they'd never have been able to solve. And of course, at the heart of that lies communication. And that, for me, was an entry point, a start to switching what I was doing from chemistry to language. And now here I am, many years later. I've been at UST for 3 years. And most of that time, I have funneled myself into the science courses. So I thought I'd just share with you what we are currently doing. This is the learning pathway that 4-year students would take. This is undergraduates. So I think, like maybe your university as well, in our first year we have just a very academic English courses, everyone takes the same course. Year two we have a faculty specific course, all the science students together. And then what I've been working on are year three and four courses. So these are discipline specific courses, and I think we have 9, actually I think we have 10, I missed one out, sorry. So these all have different materials, and our students are there, therefore separated. And the assessments that we are looking at in these two courses, at least 9 courses, are very familiar genres, I think, to our students. Right? Even if they haven't had much practice of writing these, I think they know what they are, or they should know what they are. And for that reason, I think there's a lot of face value to those. Many of my students are not going to become researchers, and I think that's a real challenge for motivation. And I also find these courses quite challenging when we have mixed abilities dealing with such specific genres that are very topic dependent and subject dependent. But on the other side, these courses are very very much aligned with what they are doing in their regular science courses. So they are bringing their research projects to us, we give them input, we give them feedback. They should use that feedback, edit their work, and send it off to their professors. So our courses are therefore like a formative type of assessment. And there's a lot of challenges with them. For me, the main challenge is really this one. I'm not sure that some of our students know why we English teachers are teaching those courses, and often ask us why then science professors are not doing that. So perhaps you've had similar questions. I get these questions a lot. Students are never really satisfied with the answers. For me, the answer to number one is yes. For me, number two is no. And number three is always a little bit more dodgy. The answer is sort of a no-ish maybe. Yeah, and none of those answers are that satisfactory, I think, because we are using texts that look like this. And our students know that, our students know that I don't know what a topological quantum system is. I don't know what a non-trivial topology is, or a trivial one if such a thing exists. I don't know what a superfluid is. I don't know what time reversal breaking is, although of course I know those words individually. And our students know that. And we do not. But we do have a role. And even I think we have a role not just in the technical language, but non-technical language. And this text, for example, has a heavy skeleton that hangs it all together, that helps us to tell the story. So most of what we are doing, or a lot of what we are doing in those courses, look at this skeleton. we look at how we can bring attitudes into the text in the right ways, in the appropriate places, how we can back reference or forward reference. We look at how we bring references in to build ideas and not just throw them in for the teacher. How we make comparisons, draw similarities, how we use language to make connections between our technical ideas precise. How we emphasize ideas and how we subordinate others. We look at how writers can hold the reader's hand. That's something I talk about a lot, to help the reader remember particular points. And then for our stronger students, how to bring it all together to tell the story and wrap things up. And so, of course, we have a role, but it's difficult for our students to see that sometimes. I wonder how much we are helping our students to transfer. These genres are transferable, but time is limited. And I wonder how much our weaker students, who are still focused on the technical aspects, are actually learning in terms of transferable skills. And but most importantly for me, we're keeping up with our science trends. I'm not an expert in this area, but as far as I know, interdisciplinary science is increasingly important. Enabling scientists, or requiring scientists, to communicate impact in other fields in wider society is increasingly important. Are we helping students and teaching them this stuff? Science is fast, becoming faster. I mean, I was looking at, I was helping one student the other day prepare a 3-minute thesis. Have you seen that? Yeah. 4 years of your life boiled down into 3 minutes. Are we helping our students to do that when we are looking at this kind of things? Communication of all types is increasingly visual, increasingly data rich. And then science is multi-directional. We're not just the one directional scientist telling us what things are. Everyone these days wants to have an opinion. Whether or not that's a good thing, I don't know, but it's a two-way dialogue now with the public and the scientists. And therefore, I think we wanted to make a few changes. This is what we have been teaching until very recently, previous courses that I have just mentioned. And this audience of these are our discipline experts. Over last summer, we decided to start converting all of this into other self-access formats, like apps and self-access websites, so that we are not teaching it in class anymore. And instead we built new curriculum, which I think some of your courses might resemble a bit more closely. Important is that we basically changed who we are writing. We are now talking to non-experts. Perhaps we language teachers have a clearer role in that. And so these are our four assessments for the new courses which we are piloting now this semester. We are halfway through. And we try to enable this to give us more opportunity for looking at different kinds of skills and different media and audiences. So we're looking more at the impact of things, we're looking at different medias, we are looking at what science, which I think some of you guys are doing as well. We look a lot at telling stories in science, looking at the history of science, or the history of scientific ideas. And then these two assessments are not so much about factual science, but about the messier areas of controversy. Which I think is quite motivating for some of our students who are maybe not going to become researchers. Writing op-eds, opinion pieces, so we are halfway through. I guess if I come back at the end of the semester, I'll tell you how it goes. But our courses, our new courses, have sort of hung under these three umbrellas. Storytelling, I don't know if you look at in the courses, which you probably know is increasingly important, increasingly used in science, many science genres, professional and unprofessional, less professional genres, oral and written genres, formal and informal, storytelling is everywhere. And humans love stories, and much of science is a story. And this is something that was really quite new to our students. I mean, everyone knows what a story is, but I think most of our students don't picture it in science. So I've just spent the last few weeks really talking about that a lot, and I think it's been quite engaging for our students. And they have to produce it as well. Communicating with non-experts, which I think are your assessments as well. I think if you can communicate a high-level idea to a non-expert or to someone who doesn't even know that idea at all, then you can communicate with anyone. So we look at the different skills that you need in order to repackage these ideas. But we emphasize a lot that we don't want students to be dumbing things down. We want, or we require them to talk about high-level new research, not simple everyday science. And it was quite interesting for me that at the start of our course, I'm teaching a chemistry course this semester, and most of my chemistry students had really no real concept that a chemist would talk to a non-chemist about chemistry. But of course they do, and they're talking to all these people, and we should be talking to all these people. And I hope that we can help our students with this. And then the third point about the messier areas. I don't believe that science is the cold hard facts that we are kind of taught that it is when we are at school. I think that's a very overly simplistic approach to science. At least when I was a science student, the higher up I got, the more I realized it was uncertain, full of controversy. And our third and fourth year students, I think, are just starting to move into that area. So this is something that we are trying to bring in a lot more to the second half of our course. This part we look at the beginning, and this is a second half. So perhaps I will leave time for discussion or questions. I just wanted to share with you what we are doing, what we've changed. If you don't have any questions, here's two of them.
Yes, I asked them to do that. Yeah, so we will have a few questions for Rebecca now, and then we'll move on to Hollywood, and then some questions, and then we'll have overall discussion. Right? Yes. So any questions for her, or sharing from us with her, or with Hollywood?
What was the impetus for the change?
Well, our previous courses had existed since the 403 curriculum change, so a few years. And I think it was just difficult for some teachers to persuade them of the point I mentioned about our role. So I think the teachers, they're challenging courses to teach. Me personally, as I coordinate some of them, I believe that a lot of it can be self-taught if students put in the efforts. And so that's why we are not scrapping it, we're just moving it to a different format. So now we're trying to build it as an app, and a website that they can access the input that we used to give them. And plus we have advisors anyway who can give feedback on the type of things that we did before. So that's one thing, but also the science faculty who we collaborate with have gradually different requests over time. So previously they have requested us to teach these courses that were very closely linked. But I noticed that for the lab report courses, which we teach in our third year, some of the disciplines actually don't require them to submit so many lab reports anymore. So while we've now built these courses up, they don't actually need them as much as they used to. So that is one.
What about, this is very much in the science courses, and that's what we should be talking about today, but you see this, I mean, it's getting slightly less specific, maybe something's before being too specific. You see, this is something that could work in other areas, or do you think this is something in particular to science, that science communication is a discipline where you need this, being able to take very abstract concepts, talk to the public, or do you see this as something potentially arts or engineering, or also going from slightly less specific, maybe?
What do you mean by specific? Because we don't have a science communication course, we have science communication for chemistry, science communication for physics. So
yeah, but clarity is specific, is if you're sort of dealing with a particular type of task, an assignment for a particular discipline, I see that as specific, and still specific, but not as specific. I think what you're doing now is science students communicating to the public.
I fully understood sort of specific there, because we're still looking at the discipline specific areas. So my chemistry students still must talk about high level chemistry ideas. I think it's really just the audience and genre that is different.
So the question is really whether that could be done in other, whether you think this is something unique to science, this kind of need to do that, or do you think in other disciplines there may be also, this could be a good model for others to be following?
I think it would be a good model for engineering. We have five different engineering disciplines, and we have the technical courses like we used to have. I think that would apply to what we do in engineering. Arts, I don't really want to comment on because I've actually never taught those courses.
I really like the way you've kind of got those two different groups. I mean, I think it's a question for all of us, like how specific is perhaps too specific? Yeah. How specific do we need to be for it to be useful and relevant to students? You know, what stage might it get so specific that actually, we are in danger of teaching things that the students don't end up needing because we've really drilled down on one task and actually the faculty don't bother with that task anymore. You know, I think that's a danger of being so specific. So I think really interesting to kind of see very specific with kind of specific with done, for a different purpose. I think it's. Yeah, I'm looking for a good term there. Less specific.
That list that you showed before, is that, that's what you used to do, is it?
On the left,
So this is no, the other one, the other list.
Oh, sorry.
This
is what we do now.
The list that's the 4 years, you mean?
The learning pathway slide, I think.
Is that?
It's
that
one. So this is what we used to do.
That's what you used to do. Okay.
We used to teach lab reports, research reports, reviews.
So the new courses.
You've still got a third year, a fourth year, a second year, and a first year.
Yeah, right. We still have this and this. These are unchanged.
We've
replaced these. So we now have
those have all been replaced with
science communication for chemistry and science communication for physics.
And what's the fourth year called?
So now we combine them. So we have, so this was a one credit course. This was a two credit course.
Okay.
And now we just have one, three credit course.
Yeah,
which I think is better.
Any initial comments? Sorry, go on.
Because our science course, I haven't taught our science course, but I know our science course has been doing this popular science thing for many years, and I've heard that a lot of students actually say, why am I learning to write about popular science? I'm never going to be like a journalist.
Mm.
I want to learn lab reports. I want to learn, I want help with my capstone project. Like, so I just wonder, that's just a comment. I mean, you might find that,
I'm sure we will
they might turn it around.
Yeah, and I'm sure that problem exists as well. I mean, equally, if they're not going to be researchers, why do I need to write a research report? I think for any genre that we teach, we have to be clear about how it transfers. Yeah, so I'll be interested to see what students do think of that. Op-eds, which is our second assignment, I think is going to be a real challenge. They haven't submitted it yet. I don't think our science students have written about opinions for a long time, and I don't think they have read much about them either, so I think that would be really difficult.
Do you think life science and environmental science, they'd be writing about opinions?
A bit more. But definitely chemistry, physics.
Just wondering, will you check or assess online things, because you mentioned you put some materials online, so you check whether they excite or assess it?
I said that I was converting these courses?
Yeah.
No, I think we will make that somehow.
So it's kind of optional?
Yeah. Okay. From what I can see so far, it would enable the motivated students who really want to develop their skills in this.
Because the general assess it seems that they have very low motivation to.
Yeah, so basically we are taking it out of everything that we require, and it would simply be a resource for students.
But can you put in a lot of speaking as well that was not here maybe during the lab report and research?
We have a presentation.
Oh, you did have the presentation, yeah.
But you're right, this is a writing course, yeah. and this is half and half.
Whereas now you've got...
No, it's also half and half.
Half and half.
So we have two writing genres and two speaking.
Oh.
Come back and tell us how the students find it.
Yeah.
Really interested.
Yeah. Yeah. Do they choose their own topics?
Yeah, so that was one thing that was important to us because they don't choose their own labs and they don't choose their own research. And some of them love it, but you know, some of them don't. But here, as long as they're high level and as long as they're discipline specific, we let them choose whatever they want.
Okay, we have two more questions. Can you wait for Eleanor and Albert, the old discussion? Or? Right, so we none of those questions, right? Okay, good. Thank you.
Thank you.